The Star Sport podcast is brought to you by Access Credit Union. Access Credit Union, funding dreams for over 50 years.
Close your eyes and pull like a dog.
And a new Irish record for Phil Healy, 22.99.
Christy Cooney hands over the Sam Maguire Cup to Graham Canty, Cork All-Ireland champions for the seventh time ever.
Hello and welcome to the Star Sport podcast. My name is Jack McCarran of the Southern Star and I'm joined by Star Sport editor Kieran McCarthy. Before we kick things off, I'd just like to give a gentle reminder to our listeners and viewers to please rate, review and subscribe to the podcast on Apple Podcasts, Spotify and YouTube. The Star Sport podcast is brought to you in association with our friends at Access Credit Union. Access Credit Union, where your bank really does matter. Choose the credit union, choose local, choose community. On this week's podcast, we're going to hear from Beara GAA Secretary Joe Blake about whether the minor grades should be left at under 17 or return to under 18 and the effect decoupling could have on rural GAA clubs across the county. Joe previously served as the Cork County Board's PRO, so is well versed on the subject and has some great insights into the existential threats faced by clubs on the Beara Peninsula. We're also going to be joined by friend of the show, Christina Desmond. Christina, a boxer from Kilnamatra, was a silver medal winner at the recent European Championships in Montenegro, and she spoke to producer Dylan Mangan about her current form and the remarkable success of Irish women's boxing of late. Later on the podcast, we'll also hear from ex-Munster player and star of RTE's Ultimate Hell Week, Billy Holland, about the West Cork contingent in the Munster squad. But first off, Kieran, welcome back. You've been away from the podcast for a few weeks. So have you had a nice break or did you get any chance to relax at all?
Not good to get away for a couple of weeks, but good to be back too, Jack, because it's now the 1st of November. So can we officially say it's the countdown to Christmas?
Can we officially say that now?
I think we can, and I'll make a confession here. During the couple of weeks I had off, I did watch a Christmas true movie late one night, so I'm already in the festive spirit, so I'm very much a child of Christmas. So roll on the next 55 days till the big man arrives.
Yeah, we already had ads on our social media today for our Christmas magazine, which is out in, I think, the 24th of November. So what's that? Just over 3 weeks away till the Southern Stars Christmas special is out. So that's when you know it's just around the corner. So 55 days. And as time would have it, there's a box of miniature chocolates in my apartment at the minute, and I've been gorging on them over the last few days. So there's an Oreo Milka one. There's a Dime one. A Christmas box of sweets that I obviously was given as a gift and I've already started. So Christmas season, Kieran, is here.
Let's begin. Like, we'd be inundated with selection boxes now and the biggest sort was celebrations and heroes and all those. Like, I'm a Cadbury's boy at heart. Absolutely love Cadbury's. I wouldn't be too much into the celebrations, to be quite honest. So I look forward to Christmas as well as the Christmas true movies and the Christmas lights. I like tucking into a couple of boxes of chocolate. So let the good times roll, Jack.
Absolutely. Well, sorry there. I'm just getting a notification here and it's kind of made me lose my train of thought, but I'm going to plow on. Dylan, you don't need to delete that because this is how the sausage is made. So our first guest on this week's podcast, Kieran, is the Beara GAA Secretary, Joe Blake, who's been talking to Matthew Hurley of the Southern Star about the minor grade and the debate that's ongoing within Cork and every county at the minute about whether or not they're going to revert to the old way of doing things and also whether or not decoupling is going to take place. Now, to me, decoupling sounds like some kind of dystopian human engineering type situation. I'm watching this program Severance at the minute and it sounds like something they'd refer to in that program, but it's not that scary, is it? Decoupling, it's basically the concept of preventing minor players of playing with their senior or adult team. So before we hear from Joe, is there anything you want to say with regard to decoupling and this overall debate, or do we just throw straight to Joe?
I think decoupling is almost a trend word in the GAA the last couple of weeks, and we've seen it in both local and national media. And like you said there, it's almost a separation for minor players. But where this is causing, I suppose, consternation and for clubs, and especially small rural clubs, is that if the minor age grade does revert from under 17 back to under 18 and there is decoupling, that means that those under 18 players cannot play adult club football. Which
actually, Kieran, sorry, just on the actual phrase decoupling there, I was saying it's slightly dystopian sounding, but you like Love Island. Would I be right in saying that? Doesn't it sound like something that they would discuss on Love Island? I'm decoupling from my partner for tonight and I'm going on a date with one of the other boys. Do they say decoupling or what do they say?
Maybe it's the GA's way of getting in touch with the younger audience, you know, to kind of borrow these Love Island phrases. As well as on a serious note, it could have huge repercussions for rural clubs. And that's, I think, what Joe Blake will hear from quite soon now, because I think what he will tell us is that there's a real danger for the six clubs in Beara, not just for the immediate future, but for the years down the line, that if these under-18s are not left to play adult football, just the impact that will have. So it's a real serious debate, not just in Cork GAA at the moment, but right across the country. And I think we'll see and read more about this in the weeks ahead and ahead of Congress next year. So it'll be very interesting to see what happens. But what we do know so far is that there's almost a kind of a clear divide between the big city clubs and the small rural clubs, because those big city clubs, they have the numbers to play out of football without the under-18s. Whereas for clubs in Beara and for clubs in Carbery too, I'd imagine that they need their under-18s. And it's not just for their first team, it's for their second team. And let's say a second team can't field. Not alone does that affect those young players, but it could also affect those older players who are just playing football for that social aspect, or you know, they're just to keep getting out the social side, keep to stay fit, to meet their friends. So it could hit the second teams of junior clubs as well. So it really is a serious issue. And as we hear from Joe Blake now, they're treating it very seriously out in Beara.
So I'm delighted to be joined here by Joe Blake, the Beara GAA secretary, just to talk about the controversy surrounding the under-17, under-18 grading system in minor in the last few weeks. First of all, Joe, how are things with you? How are you keeping?
All good. Thanks, Matthew. It's great to be here on the sports, the Southern Star Sports Star podcast.
Great to hear, Joe. So, first of all, before we kick things off, a lot of people will be unfamiliar with the word decoupling on the Irish Examiner article written by Owen Carmichael recently. So, if you could explain to the viewers in simpler terms, what does decoupling actually mean?
Means basically separation. So, at the moment, you have to be under 18 to play minor football. You can't be under 17. So what it means is that if the new proposals were brought in, the 18-year-olds would not be allowed, those under 18-year-olds would not be allowed to play adult football with their clubs. So it's a total separation. At the moment, you have decoupling at 17-year-old, at 17, under 17, a total separation. So you can't play adult football when you're under 17. So the proposal is to bring this up to under 18.
And you mentioned on the Examiner article as well that this will have a detrimental effect on the Beara division, never mind clubs and the division as well. So, this would be a really big development in Beara GAA.
Yeah, it would. So just to give people a bit of background in case they don't know the lie of the land down here in Beara. So we have six clubs. So we'd have, starting off on the east, we'd have Glengariff, then my own club, Adrigal, Castletown Beara, Beara Island, Garnish and Orton. So some of the clubs, Castletown Beara would be the highest graded, they'd be Premier Intermediate, and then you would go down to Glengariff, Beara Island, who would be a Junior C club. So where this will come into play is that numbers are tight down here in Beara. Before, we used to have five underage clubs, now we have three. So my own club and Glengariff would be formed for Cathal Óg. Garnish and Beara Island have kind of put their players in with Castletown Beara, and then you have Orton. So before, Garnish would have had their own team, Adrigo would have their own team, but we don't have that anymore. So already you can see the effects of depopulation and migration that's taking place in the Beara Peninsula. And this will have an effect down the road, without a doubt, at adult level. And if this was to come in, preventing under-18s playing at adult level, it would only speed up the process. And I think Jim Hanley, one of our Beara delegates, said at the Beara board meeting last week, that, or last Tuesday night, that it's a death by a thousand cuts. And this is another cut. And this is a big one. And it will have a big effect on players. Like, I give an example. We were supposed to have 5 teams in our Junior B Championship. And only 4 of them fielded. 1 team couldn't field. And another team had only 14 players for championship starting off. And they were able to get another player to tag off midway through the first half. So they played the whole game with the Beara 15 players. So that just tells you how tight numbers are currently. Going down the road, and I think you probably saw it in the Irish Examiner article about the numbers. I was astounded a couple of weeks ago when I was told the numbers that started in Beara. So you'd have 9 primary schools on the Beara Peninsula, and 2 of the schools would be in Glengariff. So those students would tend to go to secondary school in Bantry. So there is 7 primary schools feeding into the secondary school in Castletown Beara, and only 24 children started between those 7 schools. 1 of the schools had 0 children starting, 2 of the schools had one child starting, and another school had 2 children starting. And then the other 3 schools had different numbers. But it just goes to show what's coming down the tracks. What we're dealing with currently, numbers are very tight, but it's going to get worse down the road. And there's no point in 5 or 10 years' time where a team has 13 players and there's a few 18-year-olds outside the wire looking on, but they can't play. Then that's too late. Now is the time that we need to say stop, and just we can't afford to let this happen.
And with this minor system, it's people are saying that it could go up to under 18 level. And what would that mean? Would be, if correct me if I'm wrong, though, but that means under 18s can't play senior level. Is that correct?
Yeah, that would be correct. That the under 18s can't play adult level. Now, it's interesting because I think it was 2 years ago, possibly last year, the suggestion being put forward is decoupling. I think a lot of people, the majority of people, want to see the minor going back to 18. So the big question is whether to decouple or not to decouple. And I'm of the opinion that you don't decouple, that you would play minors, championship, league games on Wednesday nights. And then you play adults at the weekends. And like there is where the big problem is a lot of, say, teams in the city and with big numbers, they're speaking about that their under 18s won't get games, and that there's a big drop-off rate. Well, I kind of put forward a suggestion that if you look back before, there used to be a competition for the non-exam leagues. So basically these competitions were for players who weren't doing leaving certs, and it meant that clubs could still play games without their leaving certs, and they were not effectively called non-exam leagues, that you could have leagues for players who are not playing adult football. Because if you look at the rural clubs, once a player comes 18, he goes training a more night and possibly playing with his adult team. While in the bigger clubs in the city and the suburbs, that might necessarily be the case. So that player doesn't have games. So by setting up maybe leagues for players that are not getting games at adult level, it means they're getting regular, meaningful games. So it's like no other county in Ireland has such a variance in demographics, because we're trying to cater for the rural clubs in Beara, but we're also trying to cater for the urban clubs with large populations in the city. So another county in Ireland is probably doing that, and it's a delicate balancing act.
And by any chance, have you approached Croke Park over this? Have you complained to Croke Park about it?
Well, I haven't been on to Croke Park in the last couple of weeks, I suppose, if that's what you're asking. Because, I mean, at the moment, this is being discussed at Cork level. And in fairness, we had a great discussion. We've had two meetings about this. And Kevin O'Donovan, I served on the county executive for 3 years with Kevin O'Donovan, the likes of Mark Sheehan, Pat Horgan. They understand, they get it. Because you take, for example, Kevin, he's from small club down in West Cork himself. So he knows about the numbers. And in fairness to Kevin and Pat and Mark, they know the challenges that we're facing. So I suppose what we're trying to do is find a solution in Cork first. But in terms of Croke Park, I don't know if they actually worry about us, if they actually care, because you know it makes no difference to them whether, like, if a club in Beara or West Cork, you know, is unable to field or ceases to exist, I mean, makes little difference to the people up in Croke Park, while it makes a big difference to the J people in Cork. So look, we're seeing if we can come to a resolution in Cork, and there is going to be proposals for Congress at the end of February in 2023. So we'll see what those proposals are. And it was interesting, I actually got an email from a club in Tyrone. They emailed me on Tuesday night to say that the clubs in Tyrone were 95% against decoupling, that the clubs in Tyrone want to have their players playing both adult and minor football and hurling. So that was very interesting to hear from Tyrone.
And I suppose you mentioned the fear of extinction for some clubs in the Irish Examiner article. Like, there's six clubs in Beara at the moment. Say, as you mentioned there, Beara Island in Junior C. There's three clubs currently in the county championships: Castletown, Beara, Adrigal, your own club, and Oran, who are in the Premier Junior Championship next year. But you mentioned that the Beara division could be in trouble here as well. They played in the Premier Senior Football Championship, like, divisional section as well. So, like, is that a fear as well, that numbers could be going down there as well?
Well, I'll give you an example. Like, there was 24 children started in across the community, or the primary schools feeding into Beara Community School. And I think you had another 8. So that was 32 started across the peninsula. And, like, if you had 6 years of that, I did my leaving cert in 1998, and there was 450 pupils in Beara Community School at the time. And if you had 6 years of 24 children starting, you would actually have less than 150 children in the secondary school. Like, I started secondary school in 92, and there was 104 of us in the class. In 8 years' time, there's going to be 24 starting. So that's going to have a knock-on effect. And I spoke to I rang a couple of the teachers and principals around Beara just to get the numbers to see what was starting in their school. And, like, one of the principals came back and he said that, look, the people outside of Beara know, but they don't have an idea what we're facing down here, what the challenges are. And he said, in years to come, Beara will struggle to have a team, never mind the clubs. Do you know? So, I mean, like, if you have 24 children, like, I'll give you an example this year. Beara won the under-19 championship. They beat Castlehaven in the final. We had about 24 tagged off. And people might say, oh, 24, that's a fine number. That's between six clubs. And that, believe it or not, was spread across four age grades, because we had two under-16s playing. So if you have six clubs into 24, that's four per club, and over four age grades, that's one per year per club. So that's one person. No, that's on average. Some had more, some had less. But then if you start looking at, well, if there's only one coming through per year, it means that you're going to probably have to have every boy playing over the space of 22, 23 years coming out to just to field the team. And then there's always going to be drop-off rate. And then people are going to go travelling. I know my own club this year, three lads went off to Canada. So you start doing the sums and the numbers are not going to add up in years to come. No, a club mightn't face going out of existence next year or the year after, but it could be 10 years time, it could be 15 years time when clubs aren't able to field. And as I say, it would be an awful shame if a team had 12, 13 players and then they had a couple of young lads outside, one or two 18-year-olds that couldn't play. So I think the decisions we take now will be felt maybe in years to come.
And I was looking at an independent article, I think, by Dermot Crowe or somebody that you sent to me during the week as well. And he mentioned that Ollie Roe O'Sullivan, one of the best ever Beara GAA players, started playing senior adult football at the age of 14. And that day looks like it's long gone as well. So does that kind of show, like, does that make a mockery of the whole thing in a way that a player could have played senior football at 14 at that time? And now, like you have to be about 19 to play it now.
Yeah, well, I think Ollie might be an exception to the rule because he was a top 14-year-old. And in Ollie's tagged off again. Ollie's still playing. I think Ollie was 50 this year and he was tagged off and he didn't play in the championship match, but he could have played in the county championship matches, I'm not sure. But Ollie played championship last year at the age of 49. He played for Garnish. And knowing Ollie, he probably played this year as well. So back then, yeah, it was, you could play. Ollie said he played at 14 and I wouldn't doubt him one bit. But like it changed a couple of years ago where 16-year-olds could play. So if you're under 17, you could play. But then that changed. And interestingly enough, Cork actually voted against that change. Because I remember speaking at the county convention. Myself and Kevin O'Donovan had a great debate about the Nemo Rangers. And Cork actually voted against it. But when they went to Congress, Congress actually voted in favor of basically saying that you couldn't play if you were under 17. So, and look, there's a couple of fears too as well that kind of came out. And there was always a fear before about the Cork minor holding up everything, that if Cork got a run in the minor hurling or minor football championship and got to an All-Ireland semi-final or final, the whole lot would be held up. The issue with the split season, that's all over because the Cork minors are finished and the Cork 20s, but all the inter-county competitions are finished before the senior championship starts, the adult championship start in Cork. So that fear is put to a side. Another point that was raised at the county board meeting was, you know, the clubs will only have to take the hit for a year and then there'll be a flow of players coming through. There isn't any flow of players coming through in Beara. There's a trickle. And, you know, if a tap is trickling at some stage, it's going to stop and every okay. And I've spoken to clubs here and I'd be asking them, have you many coming through next year? Might be one, might be two, but every so often the club will say to me, we've nobody coming through. We've nobody coming through from under 17 to under 18. While other clubs might be up in the suburbs, might be up in the outskirts of Cork in the city, they could have 10 players, 10, 12 people coming through every year on the age. And look, it's there's different challenges to be faced in Cork. The city clubs, suburb clubs, they have their own issues, the player drop-off rate, big numbers. Some of the clubs are struggling to get playing areas for their teams. But we have different issues down here.
And you mentioned already that the Beara Division 1, the Under 19 Championship against Castlehaven, but with 24 players and the issues that you explained brilliantly there, does that kind of, you know, up the achievement of small, but that was a brilliant achievement to beat a decent Castlehaven side of the day?
Yeah, we actually beat Nemo Rangers by a point in the semi-final. And funnily enough, we were drawn to play Douglas away. So what they did for the quarterfinals was first team out of the hat at home advantage. And Douglas were drawn at home at under-19 level. And they couldn't field the team to play us. I don't know. I think maybe the lads gone away on the leaving sort holiday or something like that. So we played Nemo Rangers and beat Nemo by a point. And then we beat Castlehaven by, I think, 3 points. And it was a great achievement. But it was great to see. And I remarked about it in the Irish Examiner article. I think there was five of that team had played county championship with either Adrogal or Castle Tombear. So they were playing adult football. And I felt that those players were more developed, more advanced, because they had been playing adult football. And like, if you look at the structure of the football in Cork, the setup, I know my own club, the amount of games they were playing, I think Castletown Bear are probably in the same boat. We would get 9 league games in our division. So you get 9 league games. We also are guaranteed 3 championship matches. And we also enter the Tom Cregan Cup, which is kind of for football clubs only. And we get 3 games there. So we get a minimum of 15 games at football. And then obviously if you get to a county quarterfinal, or if you get to Tom Cregan Cup semi-final or league semi-finals, you get extra games. Something tells me we could have a lot of extra games this year. But those players, those 18-year-olds, there's games for them if they want it. Well, if they were playing maybe minor, just under 18, you might have a situation where they might be in a group of 4 for league, and they might get 3, get to semi-final, maybe 4 games. And then if they're playing knockout minor championship, they might get 1 or 2 games. Some of them might only get 6 or 7 games at under 18 level if they're only allowed to play under 18. But there's an option there if they're good enough that they're playing, and a lot of them would be at adult level when they come down and they're needed here in Beara, they could get up to anything to minimum 15 games. And I thought that stood out to me, that we had a lot of good players, but they were a lot more experienced than maybe the Castlehaven lads, because I think they might have only had 1, maybe 2 lads who had played with the senior team this year in the Haven. So I thought that was an advantage of our 18 and 19-year-olds playing adult football with their clubs in the county championship.
And you mentioned 18 or 19-year-olds as well. And another point you actually referenced at the Irish Examiner is in Adrogal's Intermediate A quarterfinal defeat, the goals for the Adrogal players actually came from 18-year-olds. Correct me if I'm wrong, no. But like, that also shows that these players are well able to play senior level.
It was actually the same player. I think we got 4 goals and 3 of them came from the same player who was an 18-year-old. And he's a very good footballer, George Shea. But he's not the biggest footballer. He's not big, like big and strong. And people were referencing like a Ben O'Connor in hurling for the Bears. Like Ben O'Connor is a big stature of a guy. Gerard O'Shea is not a big stature of a guy. He's a great footballer and a great lad. And like he got 3 goals. He got a goal, I think, against Kilshannig. Got a goal against Barry Desmond and got a goal against Bohobui. So, I mean, that just goes to show that an 18-year-old who isn't the biggest guy in the pitch is able to use his skill, and look at the impact that he made for Adrogal this year. It was really important, and we would have struggled without him.
Yeah, definitely so. And, look, there's a few other points to this, but we'll go on all day if we have to go over them and all that. But just a bit of a conclusion, like if under-18s were allowed to play senior level and it went to under-18 and that was that, would you be a fan of it going to under-18, this minor level competition? Let's just say the under-18s are allowed to play senior level, but if they're not allowed to play senior level, would you still stick with under-17 level?
Well, I think I think a lot of the clubs in Cork are in favour of going to under 18 because they feel that there's too big a gap between the under 17 and the under and then going into adult level. The other thing is, what do you do with the under 21 competition, or we call it under 20, under 21? What do you do with that? Because That's a competition that needs looking at in terms of its structure, because in a lot of places, the way it used to work in Cork in football, it was run by the divisions. So it used to be knockout. But the thing about knockout is that 50% of the teams only get one game. And it's great if you get into the latter end of the county championship, you might end up playing 4 or 5 games in the under 21 championship. And that's great. But for the team that loses in the first round, like, you only get one game. So the whole under 20, under 21 situation needs to be looked at too as well. And I know people say it's a very important grade, and I agree totally with that. But it's a great, if it's such an important grade, then why are 50% of the teams only getting one game at that level? And also the thing is when do you play it? Because before there was kind of a tradition that we'd say the division championships used to be played in March and April. But the problem is now with the split season, you have the Cork under 20s who are playing, we'd say, Munster Championship and hopefully an All-Ireland Championship. That tends to go in March, April, and it used to finish around the May bank holiday weekend before college exams would start. So I don't see the Cork under 20 manager maybe releasing the players in a split season when other counties might not be doing that. So look, there's a lot of things at play here. Again, I think these issues have to be raised, and luckily enough, the likes of Kevin O'Donovan, Mark Sheehan and Pat Horgan have taken these on board. They said they're hoping to agree to maybe meet with the small rural clubs and see if a solution can be found. Now, there's different ideas being thrown around that maybe players might have to say, we'll play adult, but we won't play minor. But the problem with that is that you're asking kids then to make a choice. You know, some of them might want to play adult, some of them might want to play minor. So look, and then people were saying, oh, you could let them play for league and not for championship, or for championship and not for league, vice versa. But it gets pretty complicated. And I think we were kind of told that wouldn't stand up under general rule. So look, there's a lot of things that need to be discussed, but I think a lot of things need highlighting too as well. And we're lucky that over the last couple of weeks, we've been given the forum, both in the media and also at the county board meetings, to raise these concerns. And I know the Cork County Board have taken them on board. They are listening to us. But I would hope that sometimes maybe the people in Croke Park would take note of what we're saying. So it all remains to be seen.
And hopefully they will take notice, because it's a huge issue, definitely. And as I said, Joe, we could be talking about this forever or a day, but we'll have to leave it there due to time constraints. Thank you very much for coming onto the podcast, and hopefully the issue gets resolved sooner rather than later.
All right. Thanks, Matthew. Thanks for having me.
The Star Sport Podcast is brought to you by Access Credit Union. Access Credit Union, funding dreams for over 50 years.
Because of the bank holiday yesterday, I didn't have a chance to write a snappy intro for our next guest. So, producer Dylan, forgive me. I'm going to steal your opening paragraph from your piece in this week's Southern Star. Christina Desmond wasn't supposed to be at the Women's European Boxing Championships even. She'd been away from the high-performance boxing unit for much of this year after missing out on being picked for the World Championships in May. But 4 weeks before, she got the call up. She went to Montenegro. She won a silver medal, and she created a little bit of history with the Irish women's boxing team. So here's Kilnamatra's silver medal winning boxer from Kilnamatra speaking to producer Dylan Mangan.
So we're joined now by Christina Desmond on the Star Sport podcast. Christina, European silver medalist. How does it feel?
At the moment, it's a bit surreal. I haven't really thought about it, but obviously I'm disappointed I didn't win the final. It was a close fight, but no, it's it's a big achievement. I know I take no notice of it, but because I'm doing it every day of the week, you know, and I've been training with a few years, so I take no notice. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I really did realize how big it was with the support I've gotten and all the messages and all I've received. It's a pretty big thing. So yeah, I'm happy enough.
Yeah, it is a big thing as well. Like, you've won competitions in the past and you've already have a bronze medal, but this is that one step further. And just take us back maybe to before the tournament started. You were kind of a late call up, and was that something that was difficult to get into the mindset for going into the tournament?
Yeah, I guess I always felt that I was kind of that bit behind and that I was only just after joining, but I actually have been part of that team. I'm from them 10 girls, I actually am the longest on the team, including Kelly Harrington, because I joined the high performance unit when I was 17, because I was in the Youth Olympics. So I've been on it now nearly 10 years. So I'm the more senior one, but still I was new on the team, and I was wondering what the younger girls would think, you know, just coming onto the team. But no, it was hard, yeah, obviously, because I wasn't really training too hard over the summer. I've said in other podcasts and interviews that my dad was sick. So our main priority as a family was to try and be there for my dad. And he's flying now, thank God, so all is well. But so, yeah, to be called up and to be only half fit in my mind, and I just decided to go for it. It was a massive opportunity. I couldn't leave it down. So, yeah, it was... It didn't work out that way in the end. I was fit enough and I was well able, so I put on a great performance. I thought myself I boxed well. So
yeah, you boxed really well. And one thing that kind of struck me was, even with those only just 4 weeks of proper training in the build up, is that you kind of seemed very fluid in all your fights and looked like you were at home. Is it something, maybe the lack of preparation, do you think that almost helped like relieve a little bit of pressure on you?
Absolutely. To be honest, I've been away from the high performance now since May. I didn't get picked for World Championships, which their excuse was that I have a job, which I didn't think was fair. So I kind of was in a bad mindset. I didn't like boxing, wanted to quit it, didn't want to be there, didn't want to train or nothing, you know. So the training I was doing wasn't even much boxing. It was just real, just to keep my fitness and my head straight. So I wasn't in a good mind space with the boxing. So coming back was just a big decision for me. And you know what it was? It was just, you know what, I'll do it for me. And it was for me alone. It was for no one else. And I think that actually was the best thing, because I had no pressure. No one expected anything of me. You know, even the coaches didn't expect anything of me. You know, it was just kind of a, here, we'll give you the chance to go. So I just had to take it on, and I did. And, you know, I haven't boxed that well in a long while. But the 4 weeks in training beforehand was hard and physical, so it paid off.
Yeah, absolutely. Do you think that it'll kind of stand you to good stead going forward? I know you mentioned there that they said that you weren't included because you had a job, but being able to show that you can perform to that level, do you think that's something that going forward will do you good?
Massive, both for me and both for my training and for my job. Now I've proved to a lot of people that I am still there, and I am able to compete with girls that are all training full time. Like, you know, most of them girls out there are all training full time, getting funded, getting paid to train. And it just shows that if I did put my mind to it and train full time, I would be able to compete with these girls as well. You know, and it's only the bare margin, and that bare margin can be closed.
And I know your career is a big part of your life at the moment. It's something that you put a lot of work into. So is training full time something that you can kind of see yourself doing going forward?
Growing up, I had to get a career. That was my main goal, was to get a career. Boxing doesn't last forever. And things can go so wrong with the boxing. It's a very, with all sports, it doesn't last long, but it's a very physical sport, but it's also a big one in your head. You know, it's hard on the head as well. It's tough physically and mentally. So I do think I will probably have to go full time if I want to make the Olympics. I just haven't thought about it yet, or thought about how I'll go around it. I suppose it's something I'll have to do to sit down with my bosses and my higher Arkies and just sit down and talk to them. So I haven't decided yet, but we'll see.
It's probably something you probably need to let the silver medal sink in before you can decide on anything like that.
Yeah, absolutely. And we've now our national championships now in January. They won't go down as a picking or a selection process. It'll just be a marker. So my aim now is to just relax for a week or two and then get back into training and go for them. And after that, then we'll see what the stories are, if I get picked to go ahead or whatever. So then we'll make the decision then.
You say your aim is to relax for a week or two, but I understand you're straight back into work pretty much. So you must be pretty tired this week.
Yeah, I only took the bare minimum, like literally the days that I needed to take, because I was so late notice. Some of my colleagues had to cancel their leave and all. So I just didn't want to push the boat out or make anyone sour. So I knew I'd come back straight on the Monday and work. But then when I came home with a medal, it was just a bit strange not having to go in, but just going in with a medal. It was strange. But it was a great buzz. They gave me a great welcome back. 5 minutes, I'd say they gave praise, and it was back to messing and slagging. And I enjoyed actually going back. But no, it was two night shifts, so I am fairly tired, and I had to go back in on the Wednesday morning then for more. I had to go to court. So I'm tired, and they had a little homecoming in my little parish here in Killamartra last night. So I haven't had a proper night's sleep since I came home, but it's adrenaline, and I'm delighted with it. It's so good to come home to such support. I don't think anyone else could get the support I've gotten in the past week or two, and everyone seen the fight, everyone watched it. And if I knew that before I fought, I'd say I'd be under a lot more pressure.
Yeah, I was going to ask about the kind of reception you got coming home to Killamartra. Like, I imagine, obviously, your family are very supportive, but the whole parish kind of come together to support you as well. So that must be great.
Oh, it's been incredible. I've got support from worldwide. I've first cousins all over the world, Canada, Australia, and I've friends traveling as well, you know, all over the place. It's absolutely been it's been emotional. It was an emotional week, like, you know, so it was. But they all met last weekend in our local village in our pub to watch my fight on the Friday and the Saturday. And I believe there was a lot of late nights there. So on the back of my achievements. So it's massive to see. And you know what it makes the most is the kids. They were just in awe of maybe not me, but at my medal, and that I was actually... That girl was on television and now she's here, you know, it was just crazy. So that's what it's all about. And to see them, that I came from that place, you know, I visited the national school this morning that I went to, and they couldn't believe that I went to school there, you know, and for me, that's mad. Like, you know, I'm just a local girl. Like, so, yeah, it's been amazing.
Yeah, it must be funny being able to inspire the kind of next generation of potentially both young girls and boys into boxing. But I was just wondering, like, what got you into boxing in the first place? Like, what was it that made you kind of decide that was the sport for you?
So my brother, I have a twin brother, we're both 26, and he started boxing for fitness for football in our local club here in Macroom. And my father's first cousin, John Desmond, was the coach, and I went in to watch the boxing, and I had to do everything he did, and I'd have to do it better. That was just with everything in life. So I started training, and eventually, after a long, long few weeks and months of begging, could I get in the ring? I was allowed in, and I won my first. I was 11 then, and I won my first Irish title when I was 13, and it's been my life since. It's been incredible, really. I wouldn't have the life I have without boxing, and I definitely wouldn't have achieved things outside of boxing if I hadn't did either. You know, it was, I'm driven, I'm independent, and I believe that's fully to do with, well, my rearing and my sport.
Yeah, and boxing is obviously a very individual, like a solo sport, but you are now part of a record-breaking team with that huge medal haul coming back from Montenegro. What's it like being able to be part of kind of a golden era, let's say, of women's boxing?
It's unbelievable. You know, I've trained with Katie Taylor and Kelly Harrington and women all over the world that are famous, and they're you know, famous in their own countries and famous worldwide at boxing, and, you know, to come back and then to just, I just played off, you know, I don't take any notice of it because them to me are my friends, like, you know, I don't take any notice, but what they've done for women's boxing and women's sport is just incredible, and I don't see myself as one of them, but I would love to be that. I would love to be someone that they'd say, you know, she did it, and especially with my career that I can do both, and that anyone could do both if they put their mind to it. And the team that went out there was fantastic. I've been on many teams and I've been abroad. We had a very tough training camp. We weren't happy with the conditions out there, but we stuck through it. We got there. We all are huge support. It was huge support to each other. We got on very well. We had a routine. We went for tea every morning after breakfast across the road. That was the normal routine. And every day there'd be, you know, if there was someone down, we'd pick each other up again. And it can be hard away from family, away from friends, and you're emotionally and physically drained. And you're nervous about competition, but the team was fantastic and every one of them did well out there, and the three that didn't win medals could have just as well won as well, like their opponents won out tournaments. So it's incredible to be part of it, and again, the same as the medal, I can't believe we did that. So I hope we did everyone proud.
Oh yeah, absolutely. Does it help having other people who are going through the same thing? You talk about it being taking a toll, like emotionally, mentally and physically. Does it help having other people around you that are going through the same thing to kind of help you through that?
Yeah, it is, because you know what, no one else would understand what we go through a day before a fight or the week before a fight or making weight. We all have the same thoughts. We all think that, you know, you think you're there by yourself, because obviously boxing is a sport that you do by yourself, and all the pressure is on you and everything's on you, but we're all feeling the same way. All of us go through the same thoughts of loss. What happens if this happens? Or if she hits me this way? Or if she does this, what will I do? We all go through that. So we talk each other through it and we get through it. But we only had, I was roommate, and my roommate was Kelly Harrington. I was very lucky to share with her for the few weeks. Well, I don't know about lucky now, but yeah, we were only just saying it the morning of the final. We were in bed resting after our lunch, and she said, imagine if our families and friends knew what we actually did, or, you know, the people of Ireland knew what we did, the hardship that we go through trying to, you know, starving ourselves the night before weighing, or going for, you know, a half an hour's jog to try and cut the weight, like, and the mental and draining part. They'd actually think we were mental, like, you know, they'd have us put away, I'd say, because you know, some people just think you just go out and box and you have a holiday, you have a great time, like, that's far from it. And we had a very tough week, 4 weeks, and but you know what, it all paid off, and it doesn't matter what we have to do, we when we come home and get welcomes like that, it's all worth it.
Yeah, I'd imagine it makes it completely worth it. Just to kind of close out there, you mentioned briefly about Paris next year, or sorry, 2024, isn't it? And looking forward, I was just wondering, so you're one of your former victims in the ring, let's say Sandy Ryan is fighting on Dillian White's upcoming undercard at Wembley. Is going pro something that you've thought about in the past, and is it something that you can kind of see yourself doing going forward? I know it can maybe be hard to think about that right now.
Yeah, so like, I'd love to make the Olympics. Obviously I've missed out on narrow margins for the last couple of ones, but yeah, I haven't really thought about it. I probably will, because knowing me, I'll have to give it a go anyway. But it's all about getting the right contracts and getting the right people behind you. At the moment, I mightn't do it so soon, but we'll see. And to be honest with you, I don't like the talk in the pro boxing. I don't like giving anyone abuse or any backlash or anything like that. So I'd probably have to toughen up a small bit if I want to go pro, but I can be the nice one. They all give out to me. I say sorry when I hit people in the ring, even when I'm fighting. So I'll have to toughen up a small bit.
That can be your motto. So let your gloves do the talking. I think we'll leave it there with Christina. Thank you so much for joining us, and best of luck going forward.
Thanks so much.
The Star Sport podcast is brought to you by Access Credit Union. Access Credit Union, funding dreams for over 50 years.
The West Cork contingent in the Munster setup have been making their presence felt so far this season, with many of them starting the recent Interpro up in the Aviva Stadium against Leinster. And Kieran, you've been chatting to ex-Munster star Billy Holland about that West Cork contingent. So before we hear from Billy, what did he have to say about the current players that are involved?
Billy Holland, he was in super form. As we know, in the last couple of weeks, we've seen Billy Holland on Ultimate Hell Week on our TV screens, and he did really well there. And I had a chance to catch up with him, and it was thanks to Pinergy ahead. Pinergy are the official sponsors of the Munster Rugby South Africa huge game that's coming up in front of a sold-out Parky Queeve on Thursday, November 10th. So again, thanks to Pinergy, I was able to get the thoughts and pick the brains of Billy Holland about, I suppose, all things West Cork rugby, because as we know from this podcast over the last couple of years, so many local lads are on that, they're playing at the top level with Munster, what I'm trying to say. We've the Witchley brothers, Josh and Fineen, and Fineen recently signed a new two-year contract with Munster, which is good news for him. Obviously, we've Gavin Coombs, who's back in with the Ireland senior squad for the internationals this month. We also have the likes of Ross Garbury's, John Hodnett. We've Keen Hurley from Clonakilty, who played the weekend. We've Jack Crowley from Inishannon. So as we all know, that West Cork rugby is on a high right now. So it was really good to get the thoughts of Billy Holland and the West Cork Mafia, as they have been described, but also to get his thoughts on that huge game between Munster and South Africa at Parky Queeve next week. Like it's sold out, like I said, but it's a great opportunity, and I'm sure a lot of local fans here have their tickets got for that game, because you're getting the World Champions, we're getting the Springboks right here on our own back door, and a sold out Parky Queeve, huge crowd, huge atmosphere. And as we know over the years, Jack, when Munster take on those big international Southern Hemisphere teams, something special can really, really happen. And it would be super if history could repeat itself in Parky Queeve again on Thursday, November 10th. And as you hear from Billy Holland now, he's quite hopeful that something special will happen that day. Delighted now to be chatting to Billy Holland ahead of a huge game for Munster against the Springboks at a packed out Parky Queeve next week. As a former Munster man yourself, Billy, how much would the players be looking forward to this one?
These type of events, they're kind of once in a lifetime, really. You know, as a professional rugby player, you get to play in a few special occasions. This is certainly one of them. You know, to play for Munster against an international side in itself is unique, but to do it in Parky Queeve in Cork, sold out Thursday night, against the defending World Cup winners is, you know, it's just a really special occasion. And you're adding in the fact that you've got three ex-Munster coaches as well on the South African side of things. So it kind of all stacks up to be an incredible evening.
When there's occasions like this coming up, does it make you want to dust off the boots again and get back out there?
Oh, yeah. I'd be a few kilos off the way I know at this stage, but I'd love to, my word. You know, I always wanted to play in Parky Queeve, to play a rugby match in Parky Queeve. That would have been a really special part of your career. And I unfortunately lost three European Cup semi-finals, which were home matches in the Aviva. And I know that if any of them were in Parky Queeve, we would have come out the other side of certainly one of the results at least. So there's definitely an element of jealousy, but look, better late than never. I hope it's something that continues on into the future. I think it's great for GA, great for Munster Rugby, and most importantly, it's so good for the people of Cork. It's good for the kids who are going to get to see some of their heroes playing in Cork. And it's for supporters who've been travelling up and down the road to Thomond Park, the big games, to finally have one on your front door in our beloved Parky Queeve makes it even more special.
You're probably in tip-top shape yourself after your exertions in the last couple of weeks. I've been following you there on TV. Like, what sort of experience was that? It seemed incredible watching from the outside.
It was mad. It was all mad from start to finish. It was, you know, you're just taken out of your comfort zone from the get-go. You're sleep deprived. You know, I think I had 9 hours sleep over the 6 days. Your mind is playing tricks with you. You're hungry. you're learning new skills the whole time. You're trying to remember things where they tell you how you pack your bag specifically, you know, what goes where and has to be perfect. And by the same, at the same time, then they're shouting at you relentlessly and getting stuck into you. So, and then on top of it, doing things that you're scared of, like, you know, scared of, you know, if you're not comfortable heights or enclosed spaces. So it's just a whirlwind of sensual deprivation, and you just don't know what's going on half the time. But it was like, I'm so glad I did it. I'm very proud that I did it, but never again.
And how much satisfaction do you take in, Billy, from actually passing at the end? I think there was a tree at the end, yourself, Satenta, and David Gillip, the tree.
Huge pride. You know, 20 of us went into it, and, you know, for three of us to come out the far side and to be one of the three, I take enormous pride in it. It's, you know, it's a real personal achievement. You know, to be recognized by those individuals, the Army Ranger Wing, they're a special group of people. They're physically, they're obviously supreme athletes, but they've just got this really high emotional intelligence, a high EQ. They're so perceptive. They're, you know, savagely intelligent people. So to get their seal of approval means a lot.
Fair dues to you. I know how you put yourself through it. I was getting tired watching you on TV. So looking at the Cork Munster group. So if you could pick one fella from the Cork Munster team to put them into Hell Week, who'd you put in?
Jack O'Donoghue, and he'd be done by the first night. He loves his sleep and his rest. Who would I put in? That's a tough to do well in it, like.
Or even just to suffer and struggle.
Jack O'Donoghue. I'd have to go with Jack O'Donoghue. I'd love to see how he'd fare in it. If you put in Niall Scannell, I'd say the DSs would give up. I'd say he'd break them.
such a great experience for you. But bringing this back to rugby now, and down to West Cork for a second, because West Cork rugby is hopping at the moment. We have so many West Cork lads in the Munster setup, and so many are impressing as well. I just see there that Fineen Mitchell signed a new contract lately. But looking first at Gavin Coombs, back in with the Ireland squad again, is he someone you've been impressed with over the last couple of years, his rise?
Yeah, big time. Look, Anthony Foley brought Gavin Coombs in when he was a tall, gangly 18-year-old who had good skills, and he beefed out into being a big West Cork man. But the talent coming from that neck of the woods is phenomenal. You know, Gavin Coombs, I think Liam Coombs really impresses me. Fineen Richerly, Josh Richerly, you know, now Jack Crowley stepping up to the plate. It's a testament to the athletic ability of a lot of these guys who probably came up through GA backgrounds and maybe didn't play your typical, you know, schools rugby. And it's great to see guys coming up to those ranks through club systems and with GA backgrounds. You know, Darren Sweeten was, you know, a trendsetter a few years back. That's why games like this are really important, because it's important for the people of Cork to be able to just go to their doorstep and watch, you know, these heroes playing. And it's so important that Munster do play games around the province as much as possible and get as much exposure. And I know they're doing it the whole time with kids camps and community engagement things, and Munster are really active in that area. But Munster is a big province, and you need to, but with a smaller population base than Leinster, so you need to really get everything that you can. But look, back to Gavin Coombs, he's a special talent. He's the type of guy you want in your team. And like he scored 23 tries or something for Munster in 50 odd games. You know, a winger would be happy with that. So he's a great lad. That's the thing about all these guys, they're proper salt of the earth lads. You know, nothing, they're the quickest lads in the world to bring you back down to earth if anyone ever gets above their station. And that's a huge, hugely important part of it too.
You mentioned there Jack Crowley and obviously Josh Witcherly today, impressed in that Emerging Ireland and talent tour a couple of weeks ago. Are these two players you can see stepping up with Munster over the next couple of years? I know Josh has over the last couple of seasons, and Jack is getting his chance now, but are they two fellas you're excited to see what they can do?
Yeah, big time. They're both really talented. You know, I would have had reservations over that Emerging Ireland tour. I thought the timing of it was poor. But, you know, the guys have come back from with a, you know, a real pep in their step. You look at Thomas O'Hearn, has been excellent for Munster as well since he's come back. So, you know, the guys who were at home from Munster were probably, you know, it was a difficult time. And then these young fellas came back from South Africa with a real pep in their step, a real buzz about them. And they've really transferred it onto the pitch, which is important. So, yeah, look, Jack Crowley, you know, I've seen him play for Cann many, many times. And he's really stepping up to the mark at the moment for Munster. You know, lest we forget, Ben Healy is an exceptional talent as an out half as well. And then Josh, you know, Josh had his first start over in Clermont Auvergne a few years ago and had a rough start to that game and came up trumps in the end. And he's another huge talent, and he's learned a lot from his brother Fineen over the years, who I'm delighted to see has signed on for another 2 years. He's a hugely talented player who probably doesn't get the recognition he deserves so far, but hopefully we see that over the years.
No, Fineen was in before with the Ireland team. They extended Ireland panel, and he's out injured at the moment, I think. But what do you think Fineen needs to do to take that next step, to almost follow what Gavin has done and become a more permanent fixture around the Ireland squad?
It's probably, some of it is, it's a bit of chicken and egg. He needs to be playing for Munster while Munster are winning as well. You know, he has stepped up, and you know, calling lineouts is reasonably new to him, and he had a great season of that last year. So it's just about time in the jersey, you know. It's about performing week in, week out, and that's what they look for up in national camp, is are you a consistent performer? And I think Fineen just needs a run of it now this season, playing in the second row, calling lineouts, and Munster back to winning ways. I think when that happens, you see more guys automatically getting up into the squad. Don't think Fineen needs to do a whole lot in regard to his game. I think his game is excellent. I think it's kind of a case of just being the shop window the whole time, and Munster winning and being a pack leader in a team that's winning. I think that's important. And then when it comes to the local derbies, the Interpros, winning them, because they're the guys you're actually competing against for those positions.
Another local guy we haven't mentioned from down this neck of the woods is John Hodnett from Ross Carberry.
John Hodnett, yeah, he owes me a jar of honey, actually, from his local beehive.
We're not trying to get that off him, but he's another fella, Billy, like, played at Carberry Rangers up till, Jesus, was he under 19 or under 21 at that level? But from that GA background, when you think of West Cork, traditionally, it's football country here in Cork, it's football territory. But to see these rugby players coming out, like we said, the Witcherleys and John Hodnett, Darren, like, it's just great to see that there's such a rich harvest of rugby players in West Cork right now.
Yeah. Look, there's a lot of talented sporting individuals down in West Cork. You look at the Roars down in Skibbereen, it's must be something in the water down there. You know, people joke about that, but it's the way of life down there. They're all out and about. There, a lot of them are from farming backgrounds. They're playing sports at a young age, and it's really important. And when you're a kid, it doesn't matter what sport you're playing, as long as you're active and you're playing a sport, what group you fall into in years to come, you know. John Hodnett fell into the rugby group. Darren Sweetland could have gone either way, and that comes in time, and that's not what's important. What's important is you've got kids out playing, and you know, John Hodnett is, like, you look at the size of him, what he does on the rugby pitch, it doesn't make sense. He's got an amazing heart, amazing engine, but just such natural power and skill. And, you know, hopefully we see much more of him over the years to come. I'd love watching John play.
And what we have now, I know it's sold out in Parky Queeve, the big game coming up, but we'll have lots of fans from West Cork travelling up to the city to watch their local heroes playing against the Springboks. So what are you expecting from the game, soberly?
What am I expecting from the game? Well, firstly, Munster have no right to win the game. You know, it's just on paper, they have no right to win, but that's not what this game is about. I just want to see guys in their rawest form. I want to see just energy, emotion. I want to see the crowd behind them. And when you see that, I think Munster will be in a good place. I think they need to have add in a bit of discipline and some, you know, so that you're not defending Mauls 5 metres out, which will be very difficult to stop against South Africa. But it's just that heart, that energy, that courage. That's what you want to see from them against a team who, on paper, are, you know, they're going to be really impressive.
And final question, so really, and you've been so kind with your time. Things haven't been going so well 4 months or so far this year, but do you think this is the sort of game? Like, obviously, it's an exhibition game, but it's a sort of game for fellas just to take their mind off the league form, to get a good game under their belt against a good team, like, obviously, just the World Champions, like the Springboks, but almost use it then. Use it as a positive to hopefully kind of launch better results and better performances coming up.
Absolutely. Look, a game like this, form holds no bearing. Form has no win memory in a game like this. So, you know, Munster perform in this game, and if they win, or even if they've just a really, really good performance, it'll just give them a huge amount of confidence. I think that's part of it. You've got a really young group who are maybe lacking a bit of confidence. And that'll be just so important for them going forward. And you're right, it could, you know, I think their season is going in the right direction. You see their performance are really, really improving. But something like this will just bring them to another level altogether, and I'm excited for it. And you know, I hope it's the occasion it deserves to be for the supporters and the players and everyone who's been involved in making this happen. I hope it is what it deserves to be.
And hopefully, another famous Munster win against one of the Southern Hemisphere teams next week. Thanks so much for your time, Billy.
Thanks, Kieran.
Okay, Kieran. Quickly, before we wrap up this week's Star Sport podcast, a quick preview of what's coming up in this week's Southern Star Sports section.
Even though the GA season, you could say, is winding to close, it's still quite busy. Good news for the Bendiscar, the hurlers last weekend. They won their county quarterfinal against Fellies, and they're now through to a county semi-final. So we have full match report and reaction from that. Unfortunately, in the road for Orhan, they brought out against Kilmurry in the Junior Football Championship, but we have a full report and reaction from that. We also have all the local soccer, bowling, rugby news. It's still quite a busy time of the year. We also have a very interesting piece from Tom Lyons on what we talked about earlier and about the decoupling from that minor age grade and what it could mean. So that's well worth checking out as well. And also the Southwest Coastal Rowing had their recent awards nights. And if you want to check out the winners of that and a full page picture special, check out Thursday Southern Star. And also on that, Jane Buckley, that young Newstown athlete who we've talked about in this podcast before, she's now on her athletic scholarship in Providence over in Rhode Island. And she had a huge win the weekend just gone. So we've full news on that. As a freshman, she raced a victory at the Big East Championships, which is for, in America, the collegiate system, the colleges and the East Coast, they all compete in the Big East. And she became just the second freshman in history to win the women's 6K race. So we have a report and reaction from that. So yeah, plenty going on in Thursday's Southern Star Sport.
Yeah, brilliant stuff, Kieran. And if you can't make it to the shops to pick up a copy of this week's Southern Star, for whatever reason, you can always subscribe online. Just go to www.southernstar.ie/e-paper and you can subscribe to the Southern Star on your computer, tablet or smartphone, App Store, Google Play Store, take your pick for less than €2 per week. Thanks for listening to the Star Sport podcast this week, and thanks as well to our producer Dylan Mangan and our reporter Matthew Hurley for their brilliant input. If you enjoy these shows, please make sure to rate, review and subscribe on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, YouTube or wherever you get your podcasts. Slán tomhúil.